So this is the last third. So last time we discussed Hochschild encyclic homology. So today's topic is Hochschild cohomology, and well, interesting things associated to it. In particular, something which is called the Link conjecture. Well, I guess lots of things in mathematics are called the Link conjecture, so this is just one of them. Okay. So, just as last time, everything generalizes to DG algebras, but for simplicity, I will stick to algebras. Just generalization is immediate. So we start with some associative algebra over some K, which is a field or a ring. It's flat over K. So last time we defined Hochschild homology, which is a certain variant of an algebra which has some interesting additional structures, such as the Kohn-Seguin differential. So there is a second invariant, which is kind of cohomological in nature, which one can associate to an algebra A. And the definition is very simple. So recall that we have the category of A bimodules, which is an abelian category. And A itself is a bimodule because they act on itself on the left and on the right. And the Hochschild cohomology of the algebra A is by definition just obtained by taking this A in the category of bimodules and computing the X group from A to itself. So for Hochschild homology, I gave you several equivalent definitions, and the last one was similar. So instead of X, we had something like Tor, some derived groups of the tensor function, of the tensor product. Here is just X, and the definition is actually much simpler. So last time there was a formula where I had two A's, and one of them was a left module over A opposite M times A, and the other one was the right module. But here it's just a left module over A op times A, or equivalently an A bimodule. So, and the first observation is that this is obviously Mareto invariant in the sense what we had last time. So if we have two algebras which have the same the equivalent categories of modules, then as we discussed last time, they also have equivalent categories of bimodules. This equivalence is compatible, I mean, sense the diagonal bimodule to itself, to the diagonal bimodule. And so these groups are just obviously the same. So there was also a Hochschild-Kost-Rosenberg theorem for Hochschild homology, which said that it's something very natural when A is commutative. So there is kind of a second part of this theorem. Actually, I never read the original paper, but I think the original paper had both statements. Actually, the proof is basically the same. So it says that if A is commutative and nice, so that if you consider its spectrum, then the smooth algebraic variety over K. So Hochschild homology was given by differential forms, and this thing is given by polyvector fields. So HH star of A is the same as, so we take the tangent bundle, not the cotangent bundle, takes exterior power, and so for homology this works in characteristic, but here we better assume that K contains Q. So all integers are invertible, okay. Okay, so this is what this thing is in the commutative case. And if you want to compute it in the general case, we need some resolution to compute these guys. We can use the same bar resolution as last time. So in general, compute using bar resolution. And And the result is a certain canonical complex, which computes Hochschild cohomology groups. So this, and the complex is like this. So it's called Hochschild cohomology complex. It's given by, so I'll denote it like this, CH with upper index. So let's say the ith term. So we take A, raise it to the power I, and then just take the space of K-linear maps from the standard power to A itself. And the differential, so I mean, an element here is what? Is a map, sort of an inary form on A with values n A. So it's something where we can plug in I numbers, I elements from A and obtain another element. So differential, which I'll denote by delta, works like this. So we have some f in this space, and then delta f evaluated at a zero ai is equal to a zero f of a one ai. Then there is some kind of alternating sum term. Where we just take the arguments and take the ith or the jth argument and multiply it with the next one, so a j times a j plus one, and then there is a last term which does the same thing as here, but on the other side. So this is f of a zero up to a minus one times a minus one. It's an immediate computation from the explicit form of the bar construction. So in particular, let's see what we have in low degrees. So in particular, here?
Yeah.
Yes, thank you. So in degree zero, so this is zero, which means this is just k, so this is just a. And so what's the differential? Differential of an element a applied to some b. Well, we only have two terms, this one and this one. Let's just vanish. And this is ab minus ba. So we see that the kernel of this is just the center of the algebra. So hh0 of a, just the center of the algebra A. This is similar to Hochschild homology. So Hochschild homology was something like cocenter, the quotient by the commutators. Here you have the kernels. And now in degree one, so this is just space, this is just the space of K-linear maps from A to itself. So what's the differential? We have some map A, then delta of F. It can be evaluated at two elements. So there are three terms now. And this is just a f of b minus f of ab plus f of ab. So this is actually just the Leibniz identity formula. So this means that f is a not just a cochain, but a cocycle, if and only if it satisfies the Leibniz identity. So HH1 of A is what? Is the space of all derivations of A. So these are cocycles. And then cobounders are differential derivations of this form, which are inner derivations. So all derivations model inner derivations. So for example, if A is commutative, then inner derivations are trivial, so this is just exactly the space of all derivations, just as we should have from this theorem. So here we have vector fields. Any questions?
Your notation is a little bit confusing. So delta A is
okay. F. So A is an element here. So delta A is an element in CH1. which is a map from A to itself. So this sits inside home AA. Now I apply this map to some other element B, and this is the result. So this is my notation. And similar here. So this is now a map from A squared to A. This is how it works. Okay. Now, so depends. No, in general, no, I mean, we have some affine variety, and these are all, say, vector fields or all functions. So in general, it's large. If A is a DG algebra, which is smooth and compact, as in the first lecture, then it's finite dimensional. But in general, no. So from this definition, there is one obvious operation which we have in Hochschild cohomology. Namely, I mean, these are just X, we can compose them. So this has the unary product. So this is an algebra. So operations. Are like this. H of A is an algebra with respect to the unary product. It's composed to X. Now, a slightly non-trivial observation is that actually there is another multiplication here. So the category of A bimodules is actually a tensor category. So we have two bimodules. We can multiply them over A and obtain the third bimodule. We did this last time. So this is a tensor product operation. It's not symmetric, but it's a tensor product. And of course, I mean, this A is the diagonal bimodule is the unit object for this product. So what we can do with two Hochschild cohomology classes, we can take the tensor products also. So we also have tensor product on HH star. However, one can notice that both things actually commute. In the following sense. So a priori, we have two associative multiplications, but they commute. So we have some classes, alpha 1, alpha 2, beta 1, beta 2. Then if we first take the unary product, these guys, and then take the tensor product, then up to a sign, and the sign is depends on the degrees. I hope they're correct. So this is the same as first taking the tensor products of these guys, then the tensor products of this guy, and then taking the unary product. Two times yeah, when I have the notes, it's not correct, it should be like this. Right, but the sign is correct. Okay, and now a simple exercise to show that when we have two multiplications, two associative multiplications or something which commute in this sense, then, first of all, they're both commutative, and second, they're equal, actually. So, corollary AB is equal to BA to A tensor B of tensor beta. Here one also has a sign depending on the degree of beta. So this is known as the Ekman-Hilton argument. It first appeared in topology when people proved that the second homotopy group of something is commutative. So the point is that first homotopy group is defined by loops, which are maps from an interval where the endpoints go to the same thing. And you can compose loops like this. The second homotopy group is defined by maps from spheres, which you can think of as a square. And then there are two compositions. First, you can compose them like this, or you can compose them like this. And these two obviously commute in this sense. And then one immediately derives that both are the same and actually commutative. So why this is useful? Well, first of all, this shows that this is actually a commutative algebra, not just some algebra. And moreover, one can write down explicit formula for the product.
What's the product then?
Which one? So there are two. The another product, we just composed X. So when you have some objects in an abelian category, then X I from, I don't know, M to N times X J to... No, it's a product, just composition. So you have two X, so then this maps into X I plus J from M to L. And if these, all these guys are equal, then there is a product. Yeah. So in general, I mean, when we compute this X group by resolution, writing down explicitly this product is not very pleasant usually. But the tensor product is very easy to write down. And it's given by the most obvious formula you can imagine. So. Of corollary of the corollary is that the product in CHA is given by, so you have two cochains, now their product is F1, F2, evaluated at some A1, A I mean, I don't know if any of you saw the notes. I hope not, because there is a lot of typos there. I mean, I tried to fix them yesterday, but only. Anyway, so this is just the stupid thing. You take the first I guys and plug them into here. You take the rest, plug them into here, and then you multiply. Okay, so this is the product on the Hochschild complex. Okay, now something interesting happens. As it turns out that you can define exactly the same complex CH by completely different procedure. So there's a completely different definition which gives the same answer. So let me explain this definition. Let me keep this for the moment. Okay, so another definition. CH. So assume first that first we start linear algebra. So assume given some say free module over our Bayes ring K. So if K is the field, then just some vector space. And consider, so let T star of V be the free associative coalgebra, or should I say DG coalgebra, or graded coalgebra. Generated by V, which is placed in degree 1. So So this is like a complex, except that there is no differential. Just so ti of v is just v to the power I. So this has structure of an algebra, but also structure of a coalgebra. And for me, the important thing is the coalgebra structure. Now, when we have the an algebra, we can consider the space of derivations. And for coalgebras, there is this dual notion of co-derivations, which is written by exactly the same formula, except in the dual setting. So let dt of v be the Lie algebra of co-derivations of this guy. It's the graded. Lie algebra of co-derivations. Now, but this guy is free. So when I have a free algebra, then the derivation is completely defined by its value on the generators. You send generators wherever you want, and then extends canonically to all the other guys. So for coalgebra, dually, we have that dti of v is canonically isomorphic to home from v to the power. Okay, so 0 I plus 1 to V. So when you have some co-derivation D from T star V to itself, you can compose it with a projection to V, and this composition completely defines your D. And conversely, every linear map from this to this uniquely extends to some co-derivation like this. Right. And now there is a following observation. So lemma. So assume that the number 2 is invertible in K.
So what is this gradient convention? Dt dot V is derivation dot.
Yeah, well, it's a graded algebra, so the derivations also acquire some grading. So this is the
induced. What does dti V mean?
Derivations of degree I. So for instance, degree zero. In degree zero, what you have, so in degree zero, so this is in degree I, in degree one. So here in degree one, we also have V. So derivations in degree zero are exactly maps from V to itself. And every such map uniquely extends to a co-derivation. Okay. And then in some other degree, you can say a map from V squared to itself. In fact, there is also degree minus 1 here, as you notice, because here we have I plus 1, so we can say I equal to minus 1. This is just V. So this guy starts with minus 1. Minus 1, 0, 1, and so on. But the interesting thing for me now is the component of degree 1. So component of degree 1 are maps from V square to V. So I think we have some map mu from V squared to V. So such a map is what? It's actually just a product on V. And we can ask whether this product is associative. And the claim is that this is an associative product if and only if mu commutator of itself. So now we treat this mu as an element of this guy here, and this is Lie algebra. So we can take the commutator. And the claim is that associativity is exactly equivalent to this identity. So let me show this. So proof. Well, we just have to compute this guy here. So, this is two. No, it's not better. Okay. So proof. So why this two appears? Because so normally, I mean, if you have some element in Lie algebra, its commutator itself is of course zero. But this thing is a graded Lie algebra. So graded means that there is some kind of odd. So there is some kind of sign coming in, and this guy is of degree one, so it's actually odd. And for an odd guy, its commutator itself is not zero, but it's just twice the composition. Just twice the composition. So what's the composition? Composition sits in dt square, so it's only sufficient to compute it on elements in V cube. So there is a map from V cube to V, and then since it's a derivation, it uniquely extends. So we have a map from V cube, then goes to V square, and then goes to V. So here we have our map mu, and here we have the following. So we extend this mu to a derivation of the whole t dot v, and this is what we obtain in this, by this extension procedure. But the extension is done by the Leibniz rule. So what we have here is basically mu tensor identity minus identity tensor mu. So when we compute it on elements, we see that this evaluated on some v1, v2, v3 is what? So this is mu of v1, v2, and then we take v3 and apply mu again. Minus the same thing, but in the other order. So v1, v2 of v3. And then this is zero exactly when this is zero, and this is zero exactly when, by definition, exactly when the product is associative. So this is the definition of associativity. So this is a very simple observation, but it's important. So now return back to the case when we have an algebra. Now, if A is an associative algebra, then we do have such an element which satisfies this condition. Then we do have this mu in dt1. So an algebra in particular is a model, so we can do all those things, obtain the Lie algebra dt, and then we have a canonical element here which squares to zero. And by this equality, we can identify this dt with our Hochschild cohomology complex, except that there is a shift now. Shift by one. And then the fact which you can check by direct computation is that so the Hochschild differential, which I wrote before, can be described very easily in terms of this M and the Lie algebra structure here. So delta of some F is just given by the commutator of F and mu. So because of this identity, this is actually this squares to zero, so this is differential, and one can check easily that this is exactly the same differential as what we had. Okay. So the algebra DT with this differential is exactly the same as the Hochschild cohomology complex, except for a shift. But why is this important? So we saw that the Hochschild complex is an algebra, so there is a multiplication. But now we also, and in particular, there is a multiplication of Hochschild cohomology, and that multiplication is commutative. But this gives us another structure on the cohomology, because this, by definition, is a Lie algebra. So what we see is that we have a canonical Lie bracket on CH of degree minus one because of this shift. So this guy is first of all an algebra, but moreover it's also a DG Lie algebra with respect to this structure. So this is called the Gerschenhaber bracket because it was discovered by Gerschenhaber a long time ago. So he wrote down an explicit formula for the bracket, which I will not reproduce. But now it's much easier to define this by this kind of conceptual construction. We don't need any formulas. Okay. So what we see is that this CH actually has two structures, and the Hochschild cohomology groups also have two structures. There is a multiplication, which is commutative and associative. And then there is a Lie bracket. So you can ask, is there any compatibility between the Lie bracket and the multiplication? And the answer is yes, and it was discovered also by Gerschenhaber. And this is very similar to what you have for so-called Poisson algebra. So for instance, symplectic geometry, when you consider functions on symplectic manifold, so there is the product, there is the bracket, and then there is some kind of compatibility. So let us formalize this. So these days, the corresponding structure is called the Gerschenhaber algebra. Gerschenhaber algebra B squared, that is what? So it's a graded commutative algebra equipped with a bracket of degree minus one. With a graded Lie bracket of degree minus one. Such that A bracket BC is equal to A bracket B times C plus, so there's some sign, AC times B. So this is the same as a Poisson algebra, except that there's a sign coming in. And then sort of a lemma, also proved by Gerschenhaber, by explicit computation, is that Hochschild cohomology is a Gerschenhaber algebra. Of course, he didn't prove it in this formulation. He just proved that here we have this identity. Okay. So this is the basic structure which the Hochschild cohomology possesses. So why is this bracket useful? Where is it used? So the main application of the bracket is in deformation theory. Let me explain this. So I had an explicit interpretation of Hochschild cohomology classes in degree 0 and degree 1. So let me show how to interpret classes in degree 2. So interpretation of HH2 of A. This is actually very easy up to a point, and then becomes really difficult and I can't say anything about it. So the easy part is like this. So for simplicity, let me assume that my K is a field of characteristic zero. And I want to study the deformations of my algebra over some base. I only want an infinitesimal deformation, so I have some kind of K tilde, which is an extension of K. There is some kind of maximal ideal, and this is an Artin algebra. Artin algebra. And M is nilpotent. Now assume given some flat algebra A tilde over K tilde, which is a deformation of A in the sense that A modulo A is identified with A. I want to these guys form a category, groupoid actually, so one want to try to classify it. Okay, so what one starts with is saying that, I mean, this is a field, which means that, so this has to be flat over an Artin algebra, so flat means that it's actually free. So if, okay, so there's this map, the kernel is an ideal here, and this ideal is just finite dimensional, I mean, nilpotent, yeah. Maximal ideal, but it's important. So a typical example would be what? K of x modulo x to some power. Actually, I also want this to be, I want this to be split, so I want this to be an Artin algebra over K, like here. So now the basic idea is that to study deformations, we first forget about the product here. And then if we just forget about the product, then these guys, they're all the same. So as simply modules over K tilde, we have an isomorphism. We can choose an isomorphism. We can choose an isomorphism. Tilde isomorphic to A times K tilde. So the non-trivial part is the product here. But now we can interpret the product here by using this lemma, which I had when I defined the differential here. So so the product in A tilde is given by some degree two Hochfeld cochain, the tilde which sits inside home and then we can use this identification. So under this identification, this guy is just the same as corresponding thing for A times K tilde. And if we do this identification, then here we already have an element which gives the multiplication on A. So multiplication on A tilde will be just a multiplication of A on A plus something else, plus some correction term. So here, but we know that modulo the maximal ideal, A tilde is the same as A. So this gamma, it lies here. A priori, it lies in this thing tensor this k, but we know that modulo m is equal to, it's equal to zero. So it actually lies in this product here. So it's dt1 of a, all I know, c h2 of a, tensor m. Now, I want this product in a tilde to be associative. So there is this condition of associativity, which means that this thing, the commutator itself, should be equal to zero. And I also have condition for associativity of mu itself. So when I plug them all together and write down what this means in terms of gamma, then the result is that this satisfies the so-called Maurer-Cartan equation. Yeah. So I just write down the bracket of this guy with itself. Mu bracket mu is zero. Mu bracket gamma is the differential of gamma. And then there is also gamma bracket gamma. And so deformations are classified by solutions of this Maurer-Cartan equation in this Dirichlet algebra, which is Hochstrom-Mulde complex. Now, when writing down deformation like this, I have made one choice, namely the choice of this identification. So there are different choices of identifications, which means that different gammas can give the same deformation, isomorphic deformations. But these are also easy to control. So
you mean this expression of mu tilde?
Uh-huh.
Mu gamma,
it depends on this isomorphism. Obviously, because otherwise these guys just live in different. Mm-hmm. Yeah. But so the space of all those isomorphisms, of course, the torsor over the group of GL, just all linear transformations. So what we have here is that. So dt0 of A times M. It's a Lie algebra, but since by my definition M is nilpotent, this is actually a nilpotent Lie algebra. And as such, so we're in characteristic zero, we have a nilpotent Lie algebra, so we can construct a corresponding nilpotent group. The corresponding group. Then the group acts. So the Lie algebra dt0 acts on the space of on dt1 on ch2, and it obviously it preserves the differential, so it's in the bracket, so it preserves the Maurer-Cartan equation. So the Lie algebra and the corresponding group, they all act on the space of solutions. The Maurer-Cartan equation, which I will denote by MC. And so the section corresponds to a change of identification here. So two solutions gamma give isomorphic deformations if and only if they differ by an action of the element of this group. So the space of deformations, so the set of deformations, of isomorphism classes of deformations, is identified with just this MC of M modulo the action of this group. And if you want not the set of isomorphism classes but the category, the groupoid, then again this gives you a groupoid. You just take the quotient sense of groupoids. So this is actually the beginning and the end of the story about deformations. So we see that in characteristic zero, deformations of an algebra are completely described in this way. This becomes especially simple when M is square zero. So the one multiplication on M is just trivial. So for instance, if K tilde is something like K of X modulo X square. So if M is square zero, then this thing just vanishes. So what we have here is just the space of Hochschild cocycles, and this Lie algebra is moreover abelian, again because there's no product. So this group is just kind of vector space considered as a group. And then this quotient becomes the quotient of all cocycles by all coboundaries. So this becomes just basically HH2 of A times M. So in the case of square zero extension, deformations are just parameterized by classes on HH2. And in general, there are solutions of this Maurer-Cartan equations. Okay, so question one, what do we do if you're not in characteristic zero? The answer, the whole thing breaks down, nothing works. Mostly because this passage from Lie algebras to groups only works in characteristic zero. And question number two, can this be generalized, say, to DG algebras? And then the answer is yes, that it can. So similar construction gives the deformation of DG algebras. And moreover, so here, essentially what we use here is DT1 and DT0. We don't use DT-1. So in the case of DG algebras, this DT-1 can also be used. And this gives us deformations of a DG algebra, or not of a DG algebra itself, but rather the category of modules of the DG algebra. So there are these extensions of the story, but they are not very deep. And other than that, I have nothing to say about deformations, unfortunately. So there's as far as deformation theory goes. Okay. Right. So, but what this shows at least is that in practical problems, if you have some algebra, for instance, and you want to study deformations, it's useful to be able to control this DG Lie algebra in some way. And to control it, the natural question is, I mean, what's the natural structure which we have here? So, as I said, natural structure on Hochschild cohomology is that of the Geschenhaber algebra. So now recall that HH of A is a Geschenhaber algebra. And so in order to be able to control this as a Lie algebra, it's useful to use also the product. But now there is some interesting kind of problem. So this statement is about Hochschild cohomology groups. So observation. And in order to solve the Maurer-Cartan equation, we cannot really work with only the cohomology group. We really have to work with the complex itself. So one would expect that this structure lifts to the level of chains, to some kind of DG Geschenhaber algebra on the CH dot of A. But if you look at it, then you immediately see that this doesn't work. This does not lift to CH. So why is this? The bracket, the structure, Look, if you have something, and then the cohomology is an algebra, for instance, of course you expect the thing to be a Bedije algebra, right? If you have something which is a Lie algebra, of course, something whose cohomology is a Lie algebra, of course you expect this to be. So naively, we would expect that there is some kind of DG Gerstner-Kabra algebra structure here. So why doesn't it work? So the bracket actually works. So by our definition of a bracket, we actually have a bracket on this whole complex, which is compatible with the differential. And the product also lifts to this level. But the problem is that here it's not commutative. So the product is not commutative. So the argument for commutativity which I gave, it only worked on the level of cohomology. So the product only becomes commutative when we go to homology. A priori, it's commutative up to some cobound. And so the natural question is, what is this? So this should have some structure, some natural structure, which should induce this Gerstner-Haber algebra structure on cohomology. So the question is, what is this natural structure? So question what is the natural structure on CH star of? Okay, a priori, it's not clear why the question is a reasonable question, but in fact, there is a good candidate. Let me explain why. So in fact, the notion of Gerstner-Haber algebra, which I just defined by generators and relations, as it happens, this thing actually has a very important geometric interpretation. So let me start with this. So geometric interpretation of Gerstner-Haber algebras. So what one can do is to ask the following question. So assume we have some Gerstner-Haber algebra B. So we have a bracket, we have a multiplication, we can compose them and obtain some other operations on the Gerstner-Haber algebra. So some kind of operations from B to some power n to B itself. One can ask, what is the space of all those operations? And there is the good answer to this question, which comes purely from geometry. So consider let D be the unit disk in a complex plane. Just a topological space, just unit disk. And consider the configuration space of n points on the disk, which are all distinct. So this is just the nth product of D with itself without all the diagonals. And then lemma. So for all n and for any Gerstner-Haber algebra B, there exists a natural map So we take b to the power n. So this is a topological space, so we can consider this homology, just usual singular homology with n coefficients. So we take the homology of this guy, coefficients n k, and this maps into B star. In other words, for any homology class of this configuration space, any homology class induces some operation on Gaussian Hilbert algebras. Okay. So I will not prove it, but let me illustrate this for n equal 2. So, example. So for n equal 2, this d square, this is just d square minus, there's one diagonal, so minus d. And this homotopy equivalent to a circle. So a circle has homology in degree 1, degree 2. Zero one, sorry. Yeah. So this is k in degree 0, k in degree 1, and 0 otherwise. So this thing gives the product, and this thing gives the bracket. And then if you look at D3, for instance, you can see the relations between the relations which I had in the definition of Gaussian Hilbert algebra. The fact that the product is commutative, that the bracket is a Lie bracket, so there's Jacobi identity. And then there's this compatibility between the product and the bracket. Okay, so normally people state this lemma in a stronger way. So there is a notion of an operat which formalizes this kind of business. So people define some kind of operat structure on these guys, and they say that the notion of Gaussian Hilbert algebra is also defined by some kind of operat, and these operats are isomorphic. But I don't really want to go into this, because as it happens, it's not a very good language for what I want to do. But in any case, there is this map. Well, one thing you can see right away. So there is an action of the symmetric group here, which interchanges points on the disk and also factors here. So this action is invariant respect to symmetric group. But here, instead of taking homology, we take the chain complex of this guy also. So this is kind of question zero, and the more precise question one. Is there a canonical map so we would take CH of A times N, then we multiply it by a singular homology complex of this geometric object, and this should map into CH of A. So a map like this, which induces say, we know this by star. So a map inducing star on homology. So this question was asked by Deligne in, I think, 1993. So this is a question of Deligne about 1993. I forgot where, in a letter to someone. He was slightly more precise. So here I only have this map, but as I said, there is also, you can interpret the composition of operations, some sort of operat structure here. So there's a natural operat structure here. And the question was, this is compatible. So there is some kind of action of this operat on here. And this has interesting history. So Deligne asked this of someone. And then people immediately proved that, of course, there is such a map, and forgot about this. And then about 4 years later, so this was So several proofs. So this became known as Deligne conjecture. Of course, although Deligne was very careful, so he never actually formulated the conjecture. He just asked the question. So immediately people formulated and proved the conjecture. Gessler and Jones, I think, and also Voronoff. And they were all wrong. But then, about, I guess, 3 years after that, so there was this famous Kantsevich formality theorem, which was proved by some kind of very ingenious, you know, combinatorics, which has some physics, some origin in physics. But then Dima Tamarkin posted a paper which had a proof of Kantsevich formality, which contained, I think, I don't know, 10 pages, maybe 15 pages, not more than that. And then it was withdrawn. So this, so Tamarkin, yeah. So it appeared on the server, and then after 2 weeks it was removed, because I was saying that something is... But the point is that the paper is completely correct. So what was wrong, it was really heavily using this Deligne conjecture. And he was relying on a proof by Gessler and Jones, which was wrong. But the argument still stood. So the idea was to correct it. So he proved in 97, he proved Kantsevich formality. Formality modulo this Deligne conjecture. But then, of course, now it became very important. Now lots of people started working on this. And then proofs of, sort of correct proofs of. Actually, I mean, it was also Tamarkin who discovered that Gessler's proof is wrong. So Gessler's proof works by some kind of ingenious cellular decomposition of this guy in some way, and it works up to n equals 6. And of course, people were too lazy to go that far. But since this was now a hot topic, I mean, he really checked, and when n is equal to 6, I mean, something goes on. So correct proofs appeared soon. I think the first was by McClure and Smith. But there were several. I don't want to name all the people because I would certainly miss someone. So I would only mention to McClure and Smith because they were, first of all, I think the first, and then they were papers really nice. And also there is a paper by Kantsevich and Soibelman, which was a bit later, but this also has some important ideas which do not appear elsewhere. So now it continues kind of settled. So what I want to explain today is some sort of how this works. But there is one problem with all the proofs which you can find in the literature. So you see, the reason Deligne never formulated conjecture is that the statement like this is obviously kind of wrong, because this complex is huge. You see, the homology of a guy is a reasonable thing, but the chain complex itself is really large. And moreover, it depends on some relevant things. For instance, replace this disk with, I don't know, C. Homotopically, nothing changes, but the complex changes. So what one needs here is not this complex itself, but this complex which is considered up to quasi-isomorphism in some sense. And then one has to kind of be really precise and make very precise sense of what happens here. So normally, the way to formalize things is like this. There's this notion of operator, which says that, well, an operator is a kind of a collection of spaces or complexes numbered by n, and then some operations between them. And these guys, or rather some equivalent, some homotopy equivalent topological spaces, form an operator. So what people say is that they take this operator, and they say that there is some other operator which is quasi-isomorphic to this one, which acts on Hochhilger homology. So as I said, this operator itself is very large, but the idea is that there's something smaller, something which is combinatorial by definition, which on one hand is quasi-isomorphic and on the other hand acts here. But the problem is that it does not quite really work that way, because usually when you want, so you have some topological space, you have this chain complex, and you want something smaller which is quasi-isomorphic to the singular chain complex. Well, a very natural thing to look for is to take some kind of cellular decomposition of a guy. And then when you have CW complex with a cellular decomposition, you have a cellular complex which computes homology. So So a natural thing to look for would be some kind of cellular decomposition of these spaces, which are compatible with periodic structures. But they don't exist, unfortunately. So there are some very nice and good cellular decompositions, but they are completely different, I mean, completely orthogonal to the periodic structure. And this was the source of the original problem with Gessler and Jones, so they were too naive, sort of. So what all the proofs do, they construct not one operat, but kind of several combinatorial operats, and then they interpolate between them in a very roundabout way. And so all the papers are long, and even Kantsevich-Sebelman paper, which is in many respects is very nice, I mean, it still has some explicit computations which one feels should not be there, just some technical computations which one wants to get rid of. So what I want to suggest is some kind of different language for the whole business, not related to operats. And this is why I haven't defined operats, which gives the same notion but makes the proof really transparent. And so let me explain precisely now what structure. So I want to construct some structure on Hochschild-Cohomology complex, so let me explain what this structure is. So I need some name, so let me call this factorization two algebras. Maybe not a very good name, but whatever works. So two algebras is usually the name of an algebra of this operat. And two stands for the dimension of the disk, because one can also consider configuration spaces for cubes or, I don't know, some kind of n cubes. And factorization refers to actually a different algebraic theory developed by Bernstein and Rinfeld. So motivated, and this is my motivation today, so motivated by Berenson, Drinfeld, notion of chiral and factorization algebras. So my definition would be geometric, in the sense that I will work with the disks rather heavily. So I consider my disk. I take its n-fold tensor product, but now I want to number the points by some finite set. So let S be a finite set. And let ds be the topological space of maps from S to D. This is just a product of several copies of a disk. Now this, so ds has a natural stratification by diagonals. So this map can be injective, so points can be distinct, but then some points can come together. So this is stratified by diagonals. And we can consider the category of just constructible sheaves on this disk, which are locally constant along open strata, which are compatible with stratification. Category of constructible sheaves. Analytic topology. Hmm? Analytic topology. Analytic. Yeah, this is just a disk. You can think, you can replace it with anything like R2, C, just some two-dimensional manifold. Suppose sheaves of K modules, and which are compatible with stratification. So this I mean, usually when you define something like this, you need a certification to be nice in some sense. But this certification is very nice. So it satisfies all the Whitney assumptions and so on. And moreover, so the open strata here, they are spaces of type something like this Dn, or maybe product of several copies of these guys. And all these, if you look at them from the point of view of algebraic topology, they are spaces of type Kp1 for different p. So if I just take Dn, then in fact this is the classifying space of the pure braid group. And here I would have the product of braid groups. So this means that this category is very well behaved. Well, in English it's pure, in Russian it's colored, I think. Yeah. Right. Okay, so there is the. Is it P? PB, I think. Yeah, okay. Right, so there is BN, which goes into the symmetric group, and this is the kernel. So such a constructible sheaf is what? I mean, for every open stratum, this is a local system. So just a representation of the corresponding group, and then there are some gluing data between them.
I don't understand. So S is a finite set.
Yes.
So why in open strata with S is just Dn? And N is the number of S?
Yes. All right. So if I take the open, no.
Oh, you mean the open strata?
No. Yeah. Lower dimension, right. All right. I'm sorry. I should have said, right. So what I mean by stratification is some kind of filtration, but then there is a closure of a stratum, and then a stratum minus all the lower ones. So the open strata means that, yeah.
What is KPN?
If you have some group, I have a classifying space of this group. This is called KPN. Or formally in topology, one says that the space of KPN, if it only has non-trivial pi 1, which is this P, there is this pi, and the other homotopy groups are trivial. And if you have something like this, then it's unique at the homotopy, so some condition on the space. So in particular, this condition implies that we can consider constructible sheaves and take the derived category of constructible sheaves. Or we can consider all sheaves and take the complexes there, complexes of all sheaves with constructible homology. So in general, these are two different things. But when we have something like this, so all the strata are just KP1, then this is the same. So the derived category of this guy is the same as the derived category of all sheaves with constructible cohomology, which I denote like this. Okay. All right. So my objects would be some kind of sheaves here, or other complexes of sheaves. Now, I have some natural maps between the spaces for various S. So I need two types of maps. So first of all, for any surjective map from F from S to some S prime, we have a map from S prime, for instance, to D, we can compose it with this F. So we have surjective map. And this gives us a map which I denote iota F from DS prime to DS. This is actually a closed embedding. So this DS prime sits here as a diagonal. So we just say that some of the points here coincide.
What's the difference between the two?
Between this and this?
No.
Prime.
Okay.
Assume we have some topological space, some manifold, which, for instance, has trivial fundamental group. We can consider the category of constructible sheaves on this manifold. And we take trivial stratification, so no strata. So in this case, a constructible sheaf is the same as a local system. So this is the same as a presentation of a fundamental group. And this means that the category of constructible sheaves. In this case, it's just vector spaces. On the other hand, we can take the category of all complexes and take inside that large category of all complexes the subcategory of complexes which have constructible cohomology. So we have the constant sheaf there, but in general, so M is a manifold without fundamental group. So we have this constant sheaf. Now if you consider the space of maps from this guy to itself in the full derived category of sheaves on M, then this is just the cohomology of M. But if we consider this space in just the derived category of constructibles of local systems basically on M, then this is just K in degree zero, because this is trivial category. It's just vector spaces. So what happens is that passing to local system, when we pass to local systems, we remember pi 1, but we completely forget all the higher homotopy groups. And so a priori, the categories would be different. And you can see it. I mean, we have the same object, but the space of maps from the subject to itself is different. However, if our space is k pi 1, then there are no higher homotopy groups. So in this case, pi 1, remember a fundamental group is enough. And in this case, the natural functor is an equivalence. So the main point is that I'm not only considering constructible sheaves. I'm considering constructible sheaves which are locally constant along some stratification. And this is important. Okay, so I have this embedding. This is the first type of maps which I need. And then the second one. So we have this. Moreover, now let me denote by UF, by DF in DS the set of maps master D such that F at S1 F at S2 means couple S1 and couple S2. Okay, so what I want to consider configurations where if two points go to different points in S1, then there are also two points in S, two elements in S. Now the corresponding points are distinct. So this is an open subset. So I removed all those diagonals here where two points which go to different points here are less glued together. And now this open subset can be actually the whole thing, but for me the important thing is this. This naturally maps into a product of smaller sets of this type. Namely, we can decompose S into the union of preimages of various points here. So S is the union of preimages of points. So we have a map from DS to the product of these guys here. So let JF be the embedding, the open embedding of this guy. And let PsiF be a map from, so I have df here. So let psi f be the composition of this open embedding and this factorization map. So I take this factorization map, but I only need it on df. B, the factorization map. Okay. Now I can give my definition. So a factorization to algebra say B is the collection of the following. So first of all, we have, so for any finite set S, we have some kind of complex of constructible sheaves on DS. So these are the objects, and then there are structure maps. There are two types of structure maps. So first of all, for any surjective f s s prime, we have an isomorphism between. So we take B of S restricted to the corresponding diagonal by means of this map. This should be identified with B of S prime. Now this restriction has to be, so for constructible sheaves you have the usual inverse images, but then also there is the so-called Schrick inverse images. So for technical reasons I have to consider those here. So these are one maps which I need. And then the second type of maps is the following. Again, for any surjective F, so this condition basically prescribes what I have on all the closed strata. So this is some complex of constructible sheaves on DS, but for all the diagonals, its restriction to the diagonal is described by the value of B on a smaller set. Now what happens on the open strata? So this condition describes what happens on the open subsets of this type. So for any surjective map, the restriction of my B to this open subset DF must be identified with the preimage. So I have this factorization map which goes from DF to some product. And I have a sheaf on every element here. So this should be the same as the preimage of a sort of large box product over S in S prime of B plus 1 of S. So I want this notion to be relaxed enough so that everything works. So this have to be not exactly isomorphism, but just quasi-isomorphisms. This is the quasi-isomorphism. And here again a quasi-isomorphism. In particular, here we can take as our F just the identity map. And then this DF is just the open stratum. So all points are different. Then this means that the restriction of my BS to the open stratum is actually a product of sheaves of n copies of of B or evaluated at a point. And then sort of conjecture. So factorization to algebras up to a quasi-isomorphism are the same as just two algebras up to quasi-isomorphism. Now, this conjecture is not really a conjecture. I mean, it's completely clear how to prove it. But just making sense of all this up to quasi-isomorphism, you have to put some kind of model structure there. So it's technically some work, and I have been lazy to do this. But it's pretty obvious how to prove it. But let me show the essential part. So let me show how the operations appear. Again, for 2 points. So for example, what do we have for a set of 2 points? So this means cardinality, and cardinality is 2. So we have this d square, and we have some sheaf b, let me know, by b of 2 on d square. Here we have the open stratum and the closed stratum. So we have the open stratum, which is the complement to the diagonal, so which is just d square. And then there is a single diagonal, which is just d. Now there is a general gluing machinery for constructible sheaves, which says that a sheaf here is the same as what? First of all, a sheaf on the open subset, then a sheaf dz on d, and then there is a gluing map which explains the gluing between the two. So this can be done in two directions, but if I use these restrictions by Schrick, so this dz is actually, so let me denote by I the embedding, let me note this embedding by I and this by j. So this is I Schrick e. Sorry, notation sucks, so this is, should be e, right? So the gluing map is the following. So I take I upper star j lower star of my EU, and this goes into EZ. Now, in my situation, I have this guy here, and its restriction to D is completely prescribed by the condition 2 here. So in my situation, B of 2 kind of z is equal to just b of 1, just b. And the restriction to the open stratum is completely prescribed by this part. So this, by this, this isomorphism 3, I know that the restriction here is isomorphic to what? To the product of this guy with itself. Again, restricted to diagonal. So the only information which is contained here, which is new, is this gluing map. So I have to compute this functor here, and then there's some gluing map. But you see, because of this isomorphism, this sheaf is actually constant. And then you compute this functor applied to a constant shift. What you get is the homology of the space. So V times B is just quasi-isomorphic to V times B times the homology of this D square. But what I mean homology? I mean not really homology, but rather the chain complex. Okay. And now the gluing map is exactly the section map. So the gluing map is equivalent to the action map from this guy to B. So this is what I wanted to do. In other words, and if I have a collection, I have a map like this, so kind of there are different ways to encode this, and one way to encode it is to consider it as a gluing map, which gives us some object on the stratified space. Right. And then, so this is only for two elements, but when you go to many elements, you get the same, and this kind of serves as a replacement of the operatic structure. So this was invented by Drinfeld, I think, this technique. And when you first see it, it looks very artificial. I mean, long definition, so on. But it has the advantage of being kind of well adapted to the problem, so it actually works. But of course, the reason Drinfeld and Bellinson invented this was not for such a simple thing as a two-algebra. They wanted something more kind of intelligent. So we have a notion of a chiral algebra, which encodes vertex algebras and things coming from physics. But actually, the definition is exactly the same. The only difference is that instead of constructible sheaves, you work with D-modules. There is a correspondence between D-modules and constructible sheaves, but it only works for some kind of D-modules, what they call holonomic regular singularity D-modules, which are rather small. And interesting examples of chiral algebras, they have very large D-modules here. But the formal structure of the notion is exactly the same. So again, we have some objects for every S, and then there are two types of maps which encode the structure. Okay. Now I think we have a break. And then after a break, I'm going to sketch a construction which shows how such a thing appears on Hochschild cohomology.
What is that, the last one yet, the addition map or
action. So the point is that, I mean, normally in the operat language, the structure of these guys would be encoded by some kind of composition between this and this and this and so going there. Here, instead of those compositions, we have the kind of the geometry of the strata in this DS coming together. And it is this which encodes the composition. Result will work better. Okay.